Hello, and welcome to NeuraQuarium. NeuraQuarium is an artificial life simulation where you can guide the evolution of digital creatures with neural network brains. Today, I wanted to showcase a predator-prey relationship between two species. The simulation I'll be using today is available for download on NeuraQuarium's itch.io page, so feel free to check it out after the video. In this scenario, I introduced a carnivore species that evolved in another simulation to a population of herbivores. These larger, pinkish critters are adapted to hunt down and eat the smaller, yellow-green plant-eaters. The herbivores lay twice as many eggs per clutch, and reach maturity sooner since they're smaller, which allows the two species to exist in equilibrium, even though the carnivores depend entirely on killing and eating their prey for survival. Evolution rarely creates a perfect clockwork machine, and the neural nets in NeuraQuarium are often messy and less than perfectly optimal. The real power of evolution is that anything works at all. These predators' hunting behavior isn't perfect, but it's enough for them to survive. And given enough time, with prey evolving to avoid them, and the predators evolving to compensate, we would expect these behaviors to improve even more. Let's take a look at this predator's brain. Now, NeuraQuarium neural nets are pretty complicated, as a brain should be, and there's not really time in this video to break everything down, but I wanted to point out a few standout features in this species that help explain their success as predators, so I'll give a very quick overview of the basic brain structure before moving on to the specific adaptations of this species. Critters' neural nets start with a row of inputs, or sensory neurons, at the top. This is the raw data a critter receives about the world. Things like hunger, pain and temperature, its sense of smell and vision. There are then a series of so-called hidden layers, the meat of the brain where inputs are transformed, combined, and calculated on, until we reach the output layer. The neurons that control the critter's body, telling it to swim forward or back, turn left or right, bite, and so on. Neurons are connected to other neurons in lower layers by synapses, which come in a few different varieties. I'll include a link in the description to a forum post explaining more about how the brains work. Tracing every connection and doing exact calculations would be a nightmare, but I'll point out some significant structures that help create this predator's behavior. The inputs I want to point out are here, in the olfactory center. Neurons that activate when the critter smells blood, methane, or sulfur. Sulfur and methane are produced by carnivores and herbivores respectively. The stronger their diet bias one way or the other, the stronger the scent they emit. Then there's this set of visual input neurons. One that registers movement, another that indicates the angle to what the critter sees, and a third that scales its signal according to the size and/or closeness of the object, adjusted for camouflage, of course. All of these inputs, after some mixing and combining with other signals, end up here. This structure of neurons, which exert control over turning and biting. We could therefore shorthand designate this the hunting center of the brain. There are other significant pathways, such as the angle from the critter to the strongest scent it detects, the presence of the color blue, which is the color of obstacles in the world, but these are the most significant for our purposes. If we examine these structures, the basic explanation is that seeing movement and smelling blood or methane activates the hunting center, while smelling sulfur suppresses or reverses this activity. So not only can the predator detect other critters and chase them, but it can tell friend from foe through their scent. Accidents do happen, as you'll observe if you watch for a while, but these critters have evolved to at least try to avoid eating their own kind. That's a pretty big deal for their long-term survival. The amazing thing is that all of these structures and relationships evolved naturally over time through selective pressure. I didn't design or edit these brains at all. If you want to observe these predators for yourself, you can download the save file I'm using from NeuraQuarium's itch.io page. There's a free demo there too, although it's a little out of date. Look for the links in the description. Thanks for watching!